Hello, YouTube. This is Tiki Bomber here, and I am making this video. I'm going to say it this right now. If I sound very distant, or if I by chance sound very slow or speedy in my speech pattern for some reason, that's because of my medication, which has overstimulated me to the point that I did not get any sleep last night, so I'm out of hyper-tiredness at this point. And I don't have anything else to do, so I decided to go poke around some other videos and looked at other people's responses, and I came across this glorious little one by Cracked. Now, you've probably seen other response videos about this particular individual, and I'm going to say it right now. Male version Sarkeesian. This dude is literally the male version of Anita Sarkeesian, and I did see, like I said, I did see the response video, so I know what to expect and how to answer the five things, or five ways that gamers are holding back the games they love. And I'm actually going to break them down, maybe, probably not 100% on that. But I'm going to break them down the best I can, or if I remember to. I'm going to explain why these five ways that gamers are holding back as a fictitious thing, and maybe even how to improve on that. So, if you don't know anything about this video, I'm going to go ahead and add a link in the description below. And I don't know. I'm thinking about maybe throwing up a question at the end of my video. So, yeah, stick tuned and let's see what we have coming our way with five ways gamers are holding back the games they love.
Hey, America. I'm Crack Senior Editor Josh Sargent, and I'm here to talk about video games. Specifically to say that we let them down, guys. They were supposed to be the future. Interactive storytelling was supposed to surpass movies.
Okay, I'm gonna stop it right here because, like I said, I've watched bits and pieces already, and which means a lot of this stuff has already been edited from the video responses that I've seen. But you guys know me, I'm gonna go ahead and go full heads on, balls deep with this shit, and probably not even edit any of this out. So I'm gonna go ahead and start off. First of all, video games, yes, they were supposed to be the future of movies, and in a way, we do have that. I mean, look at Until Dawn. The literal movie, that's all it fucking was an interactive movie on its own. You didn't have much choices other than, like, the options that you choose will affect what happens in the end. But when it comes to the actual environment exploration, the character development, like, further on developing the characters and, investigating areas entirely, the whole game itself to me felt like it was just a movie. You had a set path, you had a set area, you have to make this choice, and you have a very short limit on a lot of the scenarios to choose what to do and what not to do. That's how I felt about the game Until Dawn. Do not get me wrong. That does not mean that I didn't like the game. I just didn't like how little gameplay there was. Another example is, and I hear it a lot, is the Metal Gear Solid 4 game. A game I haven't been able to play myself, but I've been told it's more like a movie than an actual game itself. Because there's, like, huge cutscenes. About 10-20 minute cutscenes. I could be over-exaggerating on that. Again, my information about Metal Gear Solid 4 comes from friends who have actually played the game and told me about the game's mechanics or gameplay and the lack thereof. So, yeah, it is, in a sense, beyond movies as it is an interactive movie. Some games tend to be more like a movie, some games don't. So, yeah, that's where I'm going to go ahead and start that off with. I would totally do that and just run around outside at the same time, just so you know. I would totally do that, but I wouldn't be calling myself the King of France. I'd be calling myself the King of America. Yeah, I would dethrone Trump at that point. Overall, that may sound insane, but it's not insane like that. The level of violence in video games can be graphic, it can be gory, And it could also be comedic in its own way. I mean, it's like the same kind of graphics for cartoon graphics when it comes to blood loss. Animes being the best prime example of that, where they bleed out like 10 times more blood than their body actually can hold liquids entirely. I mean, seriously, just go watch almost any kind of anime out there and you'll see that and you'll laugh because it's hilarious. Wrong. It is not the only thing. But let's go ahead and see what you have to say. Okay. Four out of the five games he has listed here for the best sellers of 2016. Best sellers, not best games, just the best sellers of 2016. He has Call of Duty Black Ops. And if you guys know me, Call of Duty is not a fucking game. It just is not. Sorry. I bet that's sexy sounding. Madden NFL 16. That to me is not a video game as well. Both Call of Duty is like so overdone. It's been cooking in the oven for the past 8 or so years, and it's just overcooked to the point you can no longer identify it. And then Madden itself, this is a typical thing. There are sports games, the sports genre for video games. Sports exist to be able to get off your couch and go play them. I can understand on the occasion where you want to play basketball, but it's raining outside, so you just put it on in your game system instead. That's fine. But it's still not technically a game on that matter. He has on here, however, Fallout 4, Star Wars Battlefront, and Grand Theft Auto 5. Excuse me. Now, Fallout 4 was in fact the bestseller, and it was actually the best game of 2016. And I think Grand Theft Auto 5 came in really close at second place. It came really close to being first. Star Wars Battlefront, it's kind of weird. It's more like played, like, what was that game called? Dragon Age? So it's kind of weird on that aspect. You know, it's a kind of RPG, kind of not RPG type of game. Battle strategy versus non-battle strategy kind of scenario. But overall, the three games he listed, yeah, there is a lot of violence in them. However, from what I understand, Fallout 4, which I want to get very soon, which I have to put on my little games list to buy. And Star Wars Battlefront are more of a war-based game. Grand Theft Auto 5 would be the insane violent games because there's violent acts that can be committed for no reason other than just for you to be a dick. Don't like that bitch? Then you punch her. So, out of the five games he's listed, I've listed off two as not being real games, in my opinion. Two being more war-based games, although Fallout 4 can also fall into survival, where you can kill just because, but for the most part, you kill because you want to survive. It's not a just because scenario. In Battlefront, it's a war scenario, so you have to kill because it's a war. And then in Grand Theft Auto 5, you don't have to kill, you don't have to run over people. It's just gonna happen if you're careless when you're driving. Or because you feel like punching that bitch because she decided to turn you down to the fact that you were asking her to have sex with you because prostitution. So, only one of those games is actually a very violent game, an extremely violent game. And that's out of the five games here. Now, if I want to include the Call of Duty Black Ops, I think this is the one where you shoot down an airport full of tourists, I could be wrong about that. Where you shoot down that airport full of people in the terminals waiting to get on the planes. You walk through, you gun them down, and then that's breaking Geneva Code. But that's only if I include Call of Duty in there, and that would still make his argument right now of the four out of five games being violent, needlessly violent, very much so under the minimum par, being the first and fifth game. nowhere in the between do you see three or actually four. So let's go ahead and continue on with this cracked.
And when I say about, I mean the reason we play these games is so we can pretend to kill people. With guns specifically. Because we don't want any innovation getting between us and scratching our murder itch. One Twitter user pointed out that at the 2016 E3 Gaming Expo, 89% of the games shown were about solving problems with violent retribution. And people lost their shit at him just for saying that. Why?
Probably because the statistics were skewed greatly. I mean, I don't know all about the E3 2016 conference. I have to go back and watch some videos on that, and I don't want to do that at this point. As you guys could tell, I sound very sick. Overall, the numbers were more or less skewed, because of the fact that you're including war-based scenarios with and survival scenarios with needless violent games, and that would actually jump those numbers. But if you exclude the war-based games, if you exclude the survival games and just have the needless violent games like Grand Theft Auto 5, then only then will you see the numbers actually drop, and they will drop drastically. So yeah, they have a right to be mad, and it's not because of they were given this number of 89 out of 11% of the games. It was because the numbers were heavily skewed due to the fact that you guys are including other scenario type games where violence is a need to survive, is a need to carry on, such as in war. I'm going to say it right now. In war, you're going to kill somebody. In a war-based game, you're going to kill people. In a game like, for survival, you may kill people. You're gonna kill things, but you may kill people too. You know, zombie survivals, you're killing zombies. You're not killing people. Well, you can, but you're mostly killing zombies. In Ark Survival Evolved, you're killing dinosaurs, and you have the option to kill or capture other people from your, that's not a part of your tribe. You have the option to imprison them. In the forest, you're killing cannibals for survival while looking for your son. In all these game scenarios, you're killing because it's part of your survival. It's not killing because you're needlessly having to kill people.
Literally doing math. That's gaming. If anybody watching isn't a games folk, and if so, rude. I want to point out that games can do a lot of stuff that isn't work. There's The Sims. There's Minecraft. That's all I can think of off the top of my head.
Okay, so I actually have several games in mind that he literally left off. Other people have covered this before, but there's like the mystery genre, there's the puzzle genre, there's the, card games, which I wouldn't actually consider that a genre itself. you have survivals, you've got 2D platformers that involves you not killing people, you've got indie games alone that have game mechanics where you can kill people or you don't have to kill people. And I've played, like, Undertale would be the prime example for that, where you have the option to kill or not to kill. So there's a lot of games out there that he completely skipped over. And this is why I'm literally saying he is the Anita Sarkeesian male form. For me right now, it doesn't sound like he knows what he's talking about. It just sounds like he's saying a bunch of stuff to sound impressive and probably get some V in the side. And that's like, what the fuck, dude? You don't need to sound stupid to try and get a badge, okay? Be a gamer. Gamer chicks love gamer guys. They don't like these types of douchebags who pretend to be a gamer guy and hit on them. And say stupid shit like he's doing right now.
But we gamers still choose to spend our gaming dollar almost exclusively on recreations of the most f***ed up we see in the news. Now look.
No. I spend my money on a lot of puzzles games. I get Magic Drop 5. I've got Critter Crunch. I recently got my eye's twitching. I recently got Black Hole from a friend. I got Circuits. I've got a lot of games that are puzzle based because I like them. There's a lot of games that are mystery based, and I have a huge collection of Nancy Drew games downstairs. Nancy Drew games, which by the way is the most feminist game in existence, and Anita Sarkeesian won't touch it because it literally contradicts everything she says. Much like how this guy probably won't touch the genre because it's contradicting everything he's saying right now. Okay, so we just saw the top five games that he claims is games, and I've already just debunked that. you have these top five games, where it's Star Wars: The Force Awakens. Two Star Wars titles in two different categories, topping in top fives for 2016. Force Awakens is a war-based games. So is Avengers: Age of Ultron. Now, I'm going to say this. I did not see Avengers: Age of Ultron. I'm not a Marvel fan. I'm a DC fan. However, I do know enough about Avengers: Age of Ultron, as well as around enough friends to know that it is a war-based movie. Like Star Wars: The Force Awakens is still a war-based movie. Yes, the prequel to the first original Star Wars movie, like literally right before it happens, but they're still war-based movies. Jurassic World is a recreation of a dinosaur theme park. And you know what else happens to be there? There's Roller Coaster Tycoon, which you can have as a dinosaur theme park. There's the zoo games where the part of the management genre that you can have a dinosaur theme park. You know what else is part of that Jurassic World title? I listed it off earlier, Ark Survival Evolved. You could think of that as being Jurassic World overran. Furious 7. Hey, look, that's our counter argument for Grand Theft Auto 5. Both have the same thing of needless violence. Excessive needless violence. The difference between the Furious 7 and Grand Theft Auto 5 is Furious 7 would have a more solid storyline to follow than Grand Theft Auto 5. And I know I'm gonna get flagged for that. I don't care. And yes, I do have the game. I just cannot play it right now, but that's not why I'm saying so. I'm saying so out of my own experience in trying out the game on the PS3 and then the PS4. There is a storyline there, but it's very minute to the gameplay itself. Furious 7 has a stronger storyline than Grand Theft Auto 5. Regardless, both of them have needless racing and killing going on, but that's beside the point. And then you have Minions. Excuse me. Which, out of these five, would probably be part of the Madden game, because you're literally controlling them. You're controlling them what they do. Well, not in the movie, because they're doing their own thing. But it has the least amount of violence involved, much like the Madden games do. And it's about doing, what is it? It's about them trying to find their own roots where they can fit in and belong. And you know, out of that, the only thing that sticks out of me with the Minions, with the rest of these movies that stuck out with me about Madden and the rest of the games, is that Minions is an animated movie. Madden is the only sports genre game listed. Both of them would technically not be in their categories if it wasn't under if it wasn't for the one thing missing. Game for Madden 16 and movie for Minions. No, they're not different kinds of violence. I mean, I seen some, I think it was Gray covered this part, where you have the lightsabers, you got the car shooting, dinosaurs, which there's a Jurassic Park, Jurassic World type game, even the Legos games. Lego games, oh my gosh, talk about genre.
get it, though. This is a sensitive topic for a lot of people because we remember a time when people were trying to make video games not a thing anymore. In the 90s, there was serious discussion about whether or not games were causing all the problems in the world and needed to be banned forever. Or at least...
And I actually remember this discussion because I remember watching the news about it. I remember asking my mom about it, and my mom had told me the following. If video games is the problematic in the 90s, as it's being told about again in mid 2000s, like 2005, 2006, with what's her face, Hillary Clinton, and then later on with Brianna Wu and Gamergate, then wouldn't it make sense to stop video games back in the 1980s when they first originated, instead of trying to silence it about 15, 20, 25, 30 years later? I mean, that makes sense to me, but, you know, that's just what my mom had said. If the video games were really that bad, they would have been silenced to stop it a long time ago. The fact is, video games do not teach us to be violent. If anything, they teach us to be more social. We can be competitive and aggressive, but humans are naturally competitive and aggressive, especially when it comes to a competition. The main thing that multiplayer games, especially MMO games, happen to have is a competition of sorts. You know, you got player versus player in battle fights and duels. You also have player versus player in games like Duel Masters on the phone. You know, the Apple phone and the Android phone. There's a Yu-Gi-Oh! Duel Masters game available on that. And I know that one because my friend keeps talking about it. You also have Pokemon Go, which is a very competitive game where you're taking down gyms against two other teams. You know, you have competition in all these games. Even in single-player games, you're still going to have competition. It's called the big boss at the very end of the game. Wrong. As I said, if it was actually doing that, which it does not, but if it was proven that video games causes these violence, then yes, it would have been stopped. It's not what you're saying that, oh, you know, it's still going to exist because we have guns that exist and guns cause violence. That's because you're, again, wrong. It's not guns that cause violence. It's people causing violence. You sitting there saying a gun causes violence is like me sitting, well, a knife causes violence too. And guess what? Knives are still allowed. You know what else causes violence? Fists and feet. It is the person controlling the tool, which would be the gun or the knife, that is causing violence. Much like it is the person who is playing the video game that is causing violence. Not that video games are causing violence. I've yet to see a video game system literally jump up and attack a person outside of the first Transformers movie by Michael Bay. Literally, ass backwards, 100% wrong on that. I'm still gonna question that because your gaming credit is a lot more questionable than Donald Trump winning the election at this point. Like I've said before at the very beginning of this video, male version of fucking Sarkeesian, right here.
When I learned the true meaning of loyalty and friendship, it wasn't because some
Friendship is magic. You know, people learn friendship through television series. They learn friendship through movies. They learn friendship through real life experiences. And yes, even finding a dead body in the woods can actually cause that. video games can create friendships as well. Or in some cases, it cements them in making them stronger. I'm looking at his list right here because he just said it auto-completes to Gamergate. If that was the case, Gamergate would be the first one at the list, not the third. From what I see, it first completes Gamer Chad and then Gamer and Kings and then Gamergate, followed with Gamer Green, which I have no idea about 3 out of 4 of those topics. However, if Google was auto-completing it, you would have Gamergate as the first selection, not the third. Oh gosh, yes, it's in that list selection, but for overall, it's not the top of the list. No. Sargent is bioengineering a slave army in his basement. That's the first watch list. Give me just a second here. Okay. Everything wrong with this. First of all, you wouldn't be on a government watch list just because Gamergate it happens to be what you're involved with. In fact, the government doesn't give a flying fuck about Gamergate. They just want to make sure that people who attend the Gamergate conferences are safe and secured. That's it. That's all that Gamergate and the government has in common. Second, you want to get on the government watch list, then you need to go ahead and do a Google search of child human skeletons, how to clean bones, and best way to transport skeleton bones. That shit right there will put you on a government watch list faster, way faster than being on Gamergate. And that's a whole different topic as to why I know that. Third, being a gamer means that you're a gamer. It's not a pedigree of any sort. A pedigree is a certificate given to a specific dog breed or cat breed because of its lineage that can be traced back to a certain point. Pedigree is for purebreds, or in today's case, hybrids, or what I call mutts. That's what a pedigree is. A pedigree is a certificate that can trace your lineage back to a certain point as you being a specific breed of a dog or a cat. Nothing else involved with that. So that's aside, I'm gonna go ahead and target was it gamers. Calling yourself a gamer doesn't automatically make you a dick. Calling yourself a gamer means that you play video games. If you do not like the term gamer, then guess what? You're not a fucking gamer. It's that damn easy. If you don't like the term gamer, but you want to play video games, then just say that you're a gamer. Or just don't say anything at all about it. Like, don't bitch. Don't whine. Don't complain. Don't sit there and sound all high and mighty just because you decide that you don't want to be something, but you're still involved in it. You know, that's just like telling a white supremacist that they're not really a Nazi when they fucking are. And I'm saying white supremacists, I'm not saying the whites of America. Huge fucking difference there. White supremacists would be more like the KKK. However, the KKK is actually starting to pull back because they're going more after the illegal immigrants and the Muslims over the blacks and legal Hispanics. Okay, they have bigger issues to worry about than two races that they originally didn't like whatsoever. And they're a white supremacist group themselves. So are the neo-Nazis. They are a white supremacist group entirely. So, if you are a white supremacist, or let me clarify this. If you, Sargent, happen to call yourself a neo-Nazi, but don't want to call yourself a neo-Nazi because it associates you as being a white supremacist, then you're not a fucking neo-Nazi. Either you are or you're not. If you play games, you're a gamer. If you don't play games, then you're not a gamer. That's the end of that discussion. Wrong. It does generate a lot of internet hate, but if you write anything negative about feminism, it's going to attract a lot of hate from social justice warriors and feminists alike. Even though I will sit there and bash ideals that feminists have, as a feminist myself, I still generate a lot of hate from other feminists because my ideals do not match up to theirs. So yeah, it does draw in a lot of hate, or it does draw in some hate. But nowhere near as much hate as you would normally expect. Now, if you want to draw in a lot of hate, why don't you go and call, I don't know, PewDiePie a Nazi for an example. I don't know why I'm on this Nazi kick, I just am. You call and call PewDiePie a Nazi, and you're gonna get a lot of hate for that. In fact, you're gonna get a lot of death threats too from his fans, who are already notorious for being huge bashers. And assault and would actually go into people's comment sections, thumb down their videos, and literally dog pile, and I'm air quoting that, the person who called PewDiePie a Nazi. Meanwhile, digging up as much dirt as they can on you because, hey, you just said something insulting about my friend, who I happen to like. I'm gonna find as much information as I can about you and throw it back at your face because you're a fucking idiot for doing this. That would generate a lot of hate.